No doubt most of you, No doubt most of you have seen the movie The Fugitive. It's based on a true story. Bruce Kimball, played by Harrison Ford, is falsely accused of murdering his wife. And he spends most of the movie running from authorities trying to prove his innocence. It's a pretty good movie, a little dated by now, but most of you have seen that, yes? Okay, so you get the sense through the movie that that Bruce Kimball, Harrison Ford, the longer the movie goes on, the more exhausted he gets from all this running. But know this, he's been falsely accused. He's trying to prove his innocence. Shift gears on you a little bit, probably a person you don't know of or haven't heard of, Catherine Ann Power. Again, probably don't know that name, but in the 1960s, she was a hippie kind of liberal movement and all this sort of stuff, and she and another person or persons, I can't remember, she had more than one accomplice, but they held up a bank in Philadelphia in the process of this bank robbery. They shot and killed a police officer, and she was on the run for 23 years. Finally, in 1993, she turned herself in, and basically here was her statement when she turned herself in to authorities facing what she knew was going to be for sure punishment. She said, in essence, "I got tired of running, got tired of looking over my shoulder. Everywhere I went, I just had always fear, am I going to be found out today?" So both fugitives, one, an innocent person trying to prove his innocence, second, a literal fugitive on the run for a crime that she had committed. Here's a thought, and it'll kind of guide our sermon this morning. All of us at one time or another have been on the run, not from the law. Typically it's from the Lord. He's told us something. We've rebelled against him. We've sinned. We've violated his word. And then we go on the run. And he pursues us with good intentions. And it probably isn't bank robbery or murder for most of us. It's probably things like bitterness or anger toward somebody in our family. It's been going on, seething for quite some time. It might be idolatry. And we in the West say, wait a minute, we don't have any idols in our home. An idol is anything that just is first place over God. So it could be just about anything. It could be a car, a house, person, you name it. It could be a sin, whatever else the sin might be that the Lord has spoken to you about, revealed clearly to you over the last several months or years, and rather than deal with it, you harbor it and refuse to make it right. So when you're on the run, as we all have been, perhaps some of us are today, what do you do when you get tired of running? You just say, I'm tired of running. Well, if you would, I'd like you to take your copy of our Father's Word and go to Psalm 32. By the way, this is a great psalm also for, even if you're not on the run, next time you do run, to refer to, or if you have somebody in your life who is on the run and they're asking you for counsel, a great psalm to refer them to. Psalm 32, what do you do when you're tired of running? A little context is important. I'm often telling my students, context is king. In 2 Samuel chapter 11 and 12, you're familiar with the story, David wasn't being a good leader. It opens the chapter by saying there was a time when the kings go out to war, but David stayed home. Instead of leading his men in war, he stayed home. And he sees this beautiful woman from his balcony, and you know the story about Bathsheba. And so he has an evening of pleasure with Bathsheba, who's somebody else's wife. And then the whole cover-up begins. Well, by the way, a few weeks later, she sends word and says, oh, got bad news, David, I'm expecting. So David starts concocting a plan, and he had actually what I'll call plan A, B, and C. Plan A was just bring Uriah, her husband, home, and he'll never know the difference because they didn't have DNA tests back in those days, and so he'll just think he's the father of the baby. He brings it back from the front, and Uriah was far more honorable than David and says, I refuse to enjoy the pleasures of marriage when my fellow soldiers are at war, so he's not going home. David resorts to plan B. If I can just get him drunk, he'll never remember what happened. That didn't work, so finally plan C. He sends by Uriah's own hand a secret message, basically sealed. He's supposed to hand that to his commander, Joab, and basically the message says this, put him in the hottest part of the battle, and when it gets really, really heated, just withdraw. And, you know, just let nature take its course from there. Wow. And he thinks things are good. And he hides this sin for months. And the Lord sends this prophet named Nathan to his house. And we won't go into all the details, but basically Nathan tells this very gripping, moving story. And David is livid at this story. And then Nathan basically just kind of pulls the rug out and says, you're the guy in the story, David. And again, we don't have time to develop all this, but Psalm 51 is David's psalm of repentance, if you will. One thing I love about David, some of you are often, probably a lot of you have asked, why in the world would God call David a man after his own heart when he did all this kind of stuff? And here's my take on why he did. Because when David was confronted with sin, he always immediately dealt with it. He really wanted to be right with the Lord. So in Psalm 51, he confesses his sins. And my understanding is this, that when you get to Psalm 51, verses 12 and 13, this is a quarter of a paraphrase. David in Psalm 51, 12 and 13 says, Lord, would you restore to me the joy of my salvation? David's already, to use our terms, he's already saved. He says, I just don't have any joy in my life. Would you restore that joy to me? And then the next verse, he says this, and Lord, if you'll do that, I'll teach others about you and your ways and how you've worked with me. And I'm convinced Psalm 32 is David's fulfillment of his prayer of confession in Psalm 51. Well, that's where we are, Psalm 32. And a couple other things, and we'll dive into the text real quickly. Some of you might know the name Augustine, St. Augustine, Florida, Augustine from church history. If you know anything about Augustine's past, he was a he was a rascal, to say the least, okay? He was a very loose living was part of who he was. Even after he came to faith, he kept a mistress for quite a long time, and finally the Lord got a hold of him. Psalm 32 was Augustine's favorite psalm. He had it inscribed on the wall in his bedroom to keep reminding himself about this great psalm. And I don't know if we'll get there or not. Lord willing, sometime in this series we may cover Psalm 1. Psalm 1 could be described as the blessedness of a one who walks with the Lord. Psalm 32, I'm convinced, could be described as the blessedness of the one who stopped running and comes back to the Lord. So Psalm 32, verses 1 and 2, I'm just calling it this, the blessedness of the forgiven. The blessedness of the forgiven. Look in Psalm 32, verses 1 and 2. How blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. How blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity and in whose spirit there is no deceit. No, I don't think any mistake, twice David says, how blessed and how blessed. Two times. The idea of the blessed or how blessed is, oh, the blessings, happy, rejoicing, full of joy is the person who does X. Wow, how happy. But that's not where David used to be. But after Psalm 51, this is where he is. Well, notice how he describes what had happened in his life. Real quickly, he says, whose transgression is forgiven. I'm just going to kind of highlight the verses for sin that he uses. Transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered, verse 2. To whom the Lord does not impute iniquity, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. So transgression, sin, iniquity, and deceit. By the way, you notice David doesn't call it a misstep or a bad choice. Do you see that? He calls sin what it is, and it's his own sin. He's not calling it out on somebody else. He's essentially saying, here's what I did. The word for transgression there means to rebel, to refuse allegiance to one whom it is due. Sin means to miss the mark. It's a false step. Think about an archer shooting an arrow, aiming for a bullseye or some kind of target and missing it. You realize sometimes we miss the mark unintentionally. My experience is more often than not when it comes to my life, I miss the mark intentionally. I do some shooting, as in guns. I don't always hit a bullseye, but I'm always trying. But sometimes in my personal life, I don't even care about a bullseye. Would I get an amen to that? The Lord tells us to do something, and we just say, I'm going my own way. By the way, it kind of goes back to the first word, transgression. No trespassing sign, the Lord says. Here's a no trespassing sign, and we cross that line anyway. He uses the word iniquity, and the word iniquity means the nature and consequences of sin, especially it's often used to refer to idolatry. And David had certainly been an idolatrous man because he had worshipped pleasure for an evening more than he worshipped God when this all started. And then he says, lastly, in verse 2, in whose spirit there is no deceit. Think about how deceitful he had been to Uriah. Oh, you know, go back to the front, no big deal. And to Joab, who was the commander, who ended up fulfilling this command and getting one of his own men killed. He basically said this, oh, don't feel bad about it, Joab. That's kind of what happens in war. No big deal. So think about all the deceit in David's life. But then notice this. He says in verses 1 and 2, I'll kind of reiterate the other side of the coin. He talks about four words for sin. Then he says this, whose sin is forgiven, whose sin is covered or atoned for. Verse 2, how blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute iniquity. So he's forgiven, his sin is covered, and there's no imputation there. Nothing's been something that could have been imputed to his account hasn't been, but he's been forgiven. Now, in Bunyan's great story, Pilgrim's Progress, it's a Christian who comes to the foot of the cross and is packed, this load of sin is carried off of him. That's Bunyan's view of or picture there of salvation. That's not what David's talking about here. He's talking about after the cross, and you're walking along, and the burden of sin becomes so great. I just can't take another step. Don't vote out loud, but can you recall a time in your life when you actually told the Lord, this was a sin, I confess it, I call it what it is, and just... Can y'all remember a time when that happened? That's where David is. He said, wow, that load is off of me. And so twice he said, how blessed is the man. Happy is the man. Joyful is the man. By the way, remember the book of Psalms is a collection of songs? Can y'all do this? We have lost the music, but we still have the lyrics. It's easy to sing when you're blessed, when your life is full of joy and the Lord has restored to you the joy of your salvation. It's very easy to sing. That's where David is. But that's not where he had been. So now he's going to tell us about kind of like, let me rehearse where I've been. I'll call this the troubles of the wayward. Look in verses 3-5. Now notice he refers to the past tense when he says, when I kept, this is before Psalm 51. When I kept silent about my sin, my body wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night thy hand was heavy upon me. My vitality was drained away as with the fever heat of summer. I acknowledged my sin to thee, and my iniquity I did not hide. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and thou didst forgive the guilt of my sin. Back to verse 3. David talks about the pain, the troubles of the wayward. I think he talks about several things. First of all, the physical consequences of sin. Notice in verse 3, when I kept silent about sin, my New American Standard says, my body wasted away. Body wasted away. You know when we sin, lots of things. I'm not a doctor in the sense of a medical doctor, but it increases stress in our life. Doctors who study this stuff would tell you, especially if they're believers, people's heart rates tend to get elevated. Their blood pressure goes high. They get ulcers. All sorts of things happen to us physically when we harbor sin. Those are what I call the natural consequences. The Lord doesn't even have to step in to do that. That just happens when we sin. But then I'm convinced there's also the supernatural consequences, physical consequences to sin. You remember in the book of 1 Corinthians last week, we had a pleasure together of celebrating communion. In the book of Corinth, Paul says to the Corinthian believers, they were coming to the Lord's Supper literally soused. They were drunk. And so here's what Paul says to the church at Corinth. Because of your flippant attitude toward the Lord at this special moment, some of you are sick. Some of you, the Lord even says, taking you out. Let's not worry about that just a minute. Let's just think about the sick part. Sometimes there's a physical consequence to sin. We're not going to go there, but several weeks ago I preached a series on Moses. And remember, Moses was challenged by his brother and sister, Aaron and Miriam. They said, basically, you're not the only one that God speaks through. He speaks through us too. And God says to the three of them, Corver paraphrase, you three, come before me in the tent of meeting. In my generation, occasionally you got sent to the principal's office. I know this is going to shock you. I got sent to the principal's office one time. I'll never forget. I was probably fourth grade, and I don't recall what I did, but I remember very clearly the teacher saying, "Billy, go to the principal's office." And I'm thinking, no, because my dad had told me, if you go to the principal's office, it's going to be worse when you get home. Imagine going not to the principal's office, before the Lord. And I think because Miriam was the instigator, the Lord struck her with leprosy. Do you remember that? There are consequences to sin. And David faced them. He said, basically, physically, I was a wreck those months that I didn't confess. The months that I was on the run, I was a wreck physically. Okay, well, look in verse 3. It also says this, through my groaning all the day long. I'm just going to put beside that his emotional consequences, his groaning all the day, sighing. Just, I don't know how to put it in words, just like, he just felt like, this oppression. And tied in with verse 4, for day and night thy hand was heavy upon me. God, your hand seems to be against me. Now, I'm, again, reading the New American Standard. If you're reading New American Standard, over in the margin, here's what it says about the literal translation. My life juices were turned to the drought of summer. That's an interesting one. My life juices were turned to the drought of summer. He pictures himself as this juice, and this juice has become like a drought, his life. Now, we may not say it that way, but here's what we would say. We'd say something like this. My spiritual life seems to be really dry these days, like dry as dust or toast, just dry. There's nothing to my spiritual life. I just feel like there's this barrier between me and God. And that's what David says he felt during this time of being on the run. I think that's kind of how Gideon felt. Remember in Gideon chapter 6, God appears to Gideon and he says, "Oh, mighty man of valor," and he says, "The Lord's with you." And Gideon says, "Wow, Lord, if you're with us, why does all this bad stuff seem to be happening?" Do y'all remember this story? It's like, wow. And Jonah, when Jonah was on the run, you remember he's in the ship and he's sleeping soundly, and those sailors wake him up and say, "Hey, you know, we're gonna cast lots to see who's all responsible for this." And to use our terms, they draw straws, and he gets the short one or the long one, whatever, however you played that game, but he got the bad one. And I imagine at that point, although Jonah confessed to them, he's thinking, "Lord, the odds are, if there's 50 sailors, the odds are 1 to 50, I got the long straw. Guess what? I'm getting the long straw." He knew it. God's hand was heavy against Jonah because of the sin in his life. He's on the run. That's the problem with being on the run, or the problems. There's physical, emotional, and spiritual problems. It's pain. But what's the cure? Look in verse 5. I acknowledged my sin to thee, and my iniquity I did not hide. I said, I will confess my transgression to the Lord, and that is forgive the guilt of my sin. This is, and no slam, this is not a 6, 8, or 12-step program. God might use that, but that's not a 6, 12, or 8-step program. It's not another self-help book. It's basically the Old Testament version of 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sin, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Not most, not some, all. It's one of the most beloved stories in the New Testament. In Luke 15, the Pharisees were saying they didn't like who Jesus hung around with. And so if you read the text carefully, here's what it says in Luke 15. He told them a parable, not three parables, a parable. The first part, if you think of it, sermons, point one, there's a shepherd who has 100 sheep and he lost one and he went to look for it. 1 out of 100. Point two, there's a woman who has 10 coins in her dowry. She lost a coin. She looked for it. She swept through the dirt of her dirt floor of her house and looked and looked and looked for 1/10 of her dowry. Oh, and there's a father who's got 2 sons. and one went on the run. And finally, he came to his senses. He says, I need to go, come home because my dad's hired servants have it better than I do. And you see in the story, which is very uncharacteristic of Middle Eastern culture, the father is looking, and when he sees his son, he does not fold his arms and say, well, about time. And he doesn't say, well, when he gets here, maybe I'll say hi. He says he ran to meet his son. He ran to meet him. The father's looking for wayward children to come home. David says, that's what I did. But before I confessed my sin, wow, it was tough. It was really a long time. Well, in verses 6 to the end of the psalm, the end of the chapter, David gives what I'll call advice to all, whether you're on the run or not. He gives us all some advice in light of his experience. Here's the first piece of advice he gives us. Avoid presumption. Come home now. Verse 6, therefore let everyone who is godly pray to thee in a time when thou mayest be found. In other words, there may come a time when you can't be found. Surely in a flood of great waters they shall not reach him. Thou art my hiding place. Thou dost preserve me from trouble. Thou dost surround me with songs of deliverance. Back to that first phrase or verse 6, let everyone who is godly pray to thee in a time when thou mayest be found. And then he likens this journey to being in a flood. We're pretty familiar with floods. We had Hurricane Matthew here a few months ago. And when you're in a flood and waters are raging, you can get washed downstream real quick. He says, you're in a flood, and if you're near somewhere where there's safety, a harbor or someplace to get out of that flood water, by all means, don't not get out of the water and don't take that exit, or just take it now. In other words, don't be presumptuous and think, well, I'll take the next safe exit out of this, out of these floodwaters. The Bible in the New Testament talks about people sometimes developing a hardened heart or a calloused or seared conscience. A lot of stuff going on there. All of you remember having calluses on your hands when you were younger? Can y'all do this in my sermons? Okay. At the Bible college, I don't get many calluses now. You know, signing documents doesn't do a whole lot for your calluses. And calluses can be a God-given thing. In fact, they are a God-given thing on our hands because the friction that builds up, it kind of builds up thick skin on certain parts of our hands and our feet. While that may be good for your hands and feet, it's terrible for your conscience or your heart because that part of your body becomes insensitive to the things God's trying to do. And we ought to be real careful to think, well, I'll think about coming back home. Maybe I'll do it next week. You ever had those mornings in your life, especially this is a new year, still new in the year, and maybe you've decided as part of the new year that you're going to get in better shape. You're going to drop a few pounds and get the old cardio going, right? Okay. Some of you are thinking, no, when that feeling comes, I just sit down until it passes. Okay. But for some of you, you're thinking, I'm going to do that. And so maybe yesterday, because it was Saturday, somebody in here thought, yeah, I ought to go for a long walk. I ought to go for a jog. I ought to work out. I ought to get on that exercise bike that's just a plant stand now. I ought to do that. Or maybe have a project at home. I've got a project at home. I have a shed. It's a pretty good sized shed for lawnmowers and Christmas decorations and all that kind of stuff. And it becomes kind of like a gathering place for stuff. Anybody have something like that at home? And I think, yeah, I ought to do that this Saturday. You know, I ought to get out there and clean that up. As sure as the world, when I feel like exercising or cleaning up that shed, maybe next Saturday. Anybody ever, can I get an amen to that? Amen. Okay. I think that's really a great illustration, not because it's mine, to how we are spiritually sometimes. The Lord says, I want you to come home. And we often say, well, I'll think about that. And just between you and the Lord, what makes you so sure that next week or 2 weeks from now, you're going to want to actually come back? That's presumption to think you may want to come back later. If he's working in your heart, today's the day to come back. David says, avoid presumption. Come back now. Here's a second piece of advice he gives. Look in verses 8 and 9. To thee, O Lord, I called. And Psalm 30, wrong page. You're thinking, where in the world is he reading? Verse 8 and 9 of chapter 32. I will instruct you and teach you in the way in which you should go. I will counsel you with my eye upon you. Now here's the negative. Do not be as the horse or as the mule, which have no understanding, whose trappings include a bit and bridle to hold them in check. Otherwise, they will not come near you. That illustration of a horse or a mule. Here's the second piece of advice David gives. Don't be stubborn. Follow God willingly. Don't be stubborn. I don't know much about horses or mules, but I do know this: when they're free-spirited, you can't get them to come to you. You have to put something in their mouth and, hey, you're coming this way. So don't be like that. Years ago, the Lord blessed Marcia and I with a trip to Israel through some friends. They sent us to Israel in 2001. And we went to a place that is called Mount Arbel, which a lot of people believe was where Jesus prayed on the night when he sent the disciples out on the Sea of Galilee. It overlooks the Sea of Galilee. And our tour guide, and it's where they arranged all these things. And so there was about 30 or 40 in our group. And the ladies were going to ride these little donkeys, and their husbands were going to kind of walk beside them. And it was about a quarter mile from point A to point B. Not one of those rascals wanted to go from point A to point B. Not one. Okay? I still remember. I'm a decent-sized person, okay? And this was 15 years ago, and I worked out more than I do now. This donkey was not that big. Just basically, whatever you call that little strap between here and here, okay? Just grabbing that thing, thinking, listen, pal, I'm bigger than you. You're coming with me, okay? And so Marcia's sitting on this thing, and all the ladies in our group are thinking, why did we ever sign up for this, okay? I just grabbed that thing like, let's go, guy. And he was kind of like, you know, and I'm thinking, no, come on, let's go. And Balaam's donkey aside, if donkeys could talk, I'm pretty sure he would have said, wow, that was not a fun trip. That guy just kind of manhandled me. And here's what the Lord's saying to us. You can come willingly. It's a lot better. Now, here's the great thing about our Lord. He doesn't usually manhandle us. Sometimes he just lets us go our way. And you wonder why you get way out wherever. How did this happen? And if the Lord were to speak audibly, he'd say, because I just let you go. You just wandered like a mule or a horse with no bit, just kind of doing whatever. Don't do that, he says. Don't be like a mule or a horse who just goes its own way and has to be put a bit in its mouth and be basically forcibly drugged somewhere. Here's this last piece of advice for us. I'm just going to give it to you, then I'll read it. Choose carefully the path you'll take. Look in verse 10. Many are the sorrows of the wicked, but he who trusts in the Lord, loving kindness shall surround him. Be glad in the Lord and rejoice, you righteous ones. Shout for joy, all you upright in heart. Back to verse 10. Notice the huge contrast. The first half of the verse. Many are the sorrows of the wicked. David would add this. I had lots and lots of sorrows the last several months. Lots of consequences. We read a few of them. Some of them we didn't read when Nathan pronounced the consequences to his sin. It would be lots and lots of consequences. Many are the sorrows of the wicked. But then that great contrastive word, but he who trusts in the Lord, loving kindness shall surround him. Choose very carefully. Choose in thinking long term. I often tell my students at the college, I teach a class called Knowing God's Will. Make your decisions based on thinking 25 years from now, will I like the decision I made today or decisions I made today? So many of our decisions are short term and they're really, really foolish. And without segregating the congregation, if you're under, I'll arbitrarily say this, under 35, surround yourself with people who've been down the road a lot longer than you have. Trust me, all of us who are way past 35 can tell you some wise decisions we made, and all of us are an abundance of illustrations of some bad decisions we made. Do I hear anybody over 35 saying amen to that one? Amen. Just be real careful in your choices. I'm confident David would say this. looking back perhaps a year ago in his life, wow, if I'd have known then what I know now, that fling with Bathsheba would have never happened, because there's been nothing but sorrow in my life since then. Really painful. We talked about being on the run. This isn't me, this is God's word, I'm convinced, saying this. If you're on the run, the welcome mat is out. The Lord doesn't say you're not welcome. The welcome mat is out. That does not mean when you make the decision to return home that there will be no consequences to that period of rebellion. But the welcome mat is always out. And joy and blessedness await if you come home. We encourage you to come home. Father, we're grateful for this day. Thank you for Psalm 32. It's refreshing honesty. Your word doesn't whitewash, doesn't sugarcoat things. David clearly committed some very heinous sins. He tried to hide them for months. And when he was called on the carpet, he confessed them. And Lord, this great psalm talks about those who have been on the run and how they can come home. Lord, I pray that you'd help each one of us, not if, but when we go on the run, to come home. Perhaps somebody needs to make that choice today. We are so prone to wander, so prone to leave the God who loves us. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.